Well, it seems that few things in our world get people talking or get those clicks more than a good controversy or a good scandal. And because we live in a world with a 24-hour news cycle, it seems that there's always something new for people to discuss and to gossip about. But even in the midst of all of this controversy, all of this scandal, all those articles getting all those clicks, there's a scandal that's been operating in the local churches right underneath our noses that it seems that almost nobody's even talking about. In fact, there's a good possibility that it's even happening in your local church. What is this scandal? Well, I'm almost embarrassed even to say it. It's passive Christianity. At the outset of this discussion, I want to be very clear that I'm not criticizing the church because I love to criticize. I know that there are some ministries who seem to delight in tearing down things that other people are doing, and that's not my intention. However, I also know that there are some who get uncomfortable any time that you want to offer a critique, thinking that it's maybe somehow unloving or mean-spirited in general. But for folks that I meet like that, I need to remind them that our New Testament exists as a monument to the fact that men like the Apostle Paul were given to the church by Christ for the purpose of giving rebuke and correction when necessary. And so as we look to the New Testament documents and we see what Christ's church is supposed to be, when we then take our eyes off the pages and look into our world and see that our world is not matching what Christ described, what the apostles wrote about, then we should be free to, in love, say, why don't we reform our ways and stop looking like the world and start looking like what we read about in the scriptures? I also want to be very careful because it might sound like I'm critiquing maybe mega churches or something else, but this is a discussion about passive Christianity, and passive churches exist in multiple ways, shapes, and forms. You can have a mega church that is very passive, but you can also have a home church that is very passive and everywhere in between. And so this scandalous thing that we're describing is not mega churches, it's not home churches, it's not churches that meet in buildings with stained glass windows or in those who meet just simply in auditoriums, but we're talking about the scandal of passive Christianity. It's important to understand that a scandal is something that brings shame and reproach. It often ruins reputations, and it can be very embarrassing. But this particular scandal, unlike the ones that deal with gross immorality or other things that you might click on those articles or hear about in other news cycles, this particular scandal is one that many people don't even realize that it is ruining the reputation of Christ's church. This is something that not only has been ignored in some circles, in other circles is actually celebrated and embraced. At the heart of this issue is a theology of what the church is supposed to be about. And we can summarize this with this simple question: is the church about entertainment or about edification? As I read the scriptures, it seems that entertainment was one of the last things on the mind of Christ and the apostles, and yet that seems to be at the forefront of much of our local church ministry. If we're thinking about the edification of the church, then we're going to do things the way that we see in scripture. But if we're doing things for the sake of entertainment or simply for logistical reasons, then it makes sense why we do things the way that we do. When you walk into most local churches in the United States, our places of worship, our sanctuaries, are arranged just like our places of entertainment, our theaters. If you were to go and see a movie or a play, you would find that the auditorium there is set up just like our places of worship, with a bunch of chairs or pews and seats all pointed in the same general direction so that we can look at the stage, and then all of the leaders, the important people, so to speak, are up on the stage or on the screen. And the people who are passively watching, they don't really contribute anything other than putting their money to either buy their tickets or put it in the plate as it goes by. This passive idea of us sitting in the pews allows for Hollywood to guarantee that every single time you go and buy a ticket and sit in a theater, you're getting an identical experience. And likewise, the local church has often tried to do that same thing, to offer identical experiences at multiple times for your convenience so that we can come and passively sit and receive from the few prominent active people who are on the stage. But the Bible describes something very different. And so while we might understand the logistical reasons of why this happens, because it's easy, it's clean, we can guarantee that we can get our message across, it is not what we read about in the pages of Scripture. If we contrast this with what we do read about in the Scripture, we see that one of the most prominent metaphors for the church is the body of Christ. The Apostle Paul spent a lot of time discussing the importance of each individual member, just like in your own physical body. In our own physical body, some of our members are more prominent and others are less prominent, but they are all important and each part has to do its role, otherwise our body will be handicapped. As we look at the role of the modern American church, what we see is a few prominent members doing all of the work, and then everything else is really unnecessary. But think about your own body for a second. Which parts of your body would you deem irrelevant or unnecessary? Think of it another way. If you were to wake up in the morning and members of your body were missing, don't you think that you would notice? And yet, because we have created a model of passive Christianity where most members of the body are completely irrelevant, people can come and go without anybody ever even noticing. In an active church, every member is going to do its part, which would make it impossible to guarantee identical services no matter who attends. Because if every member is active, then the presence of those members is going to affect every other member. Now, what I'm not saying is that every member then becomes prominent, that we need to make sure we carve out an opportunity for everyone to stand on stage or to speak into a microphone. However, the body itself has some prominent members and some less prominent members, but that is not a call to passivity. We are still called to use our gifts and to be active, not just on Sunday morning, but in the life of the body in general. In fact, this is exactly what we read about in the pages of Scripture. Is that as each member of the body, the prominent members and the less prominent members, as every part does its work, then the body itself will be built up in love. The greatest edification of the church isn't this entertainment model with everybody being passive except for a few active prominent members, but the greatest edification of the church, and then by extension, the greatest evangelization of the world, will occur when every member is active and doing its part. This is the design of God, and it's much better than the design of our Hollywood entertainment industry. When we think about the early church, there are few places that have a more scandalous reputation than the church at Corinth. And with all of the immoral things and the division and the lawsuits and everything else that was going on in Corinth, the Apostle Paul reprimanded these believers because in their sin, they were failing to do what the church was supposed to do, which was to promote the knowledge of God to everyone in the community. The Apostle Paul explicitly wrote that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that they should be ashamed, because it was scandalous that there were people in their community who had no knowledge of God, because the people who knew God were too busy doing something else to promote God's glory and greatness to those who were still separated from God in their sins. We who know the Savior should be built up so that we can go into the world and proclaim the excellencies and goodness of God, not proclaiming ourselves, but pointing people to Jesus. And so an active church is the only way for this to be accomplished. And the Apostle Paul, when he looked at those in Corinth who were failing to do that, who were sinning, he said, "You should be ashamed." And so passive churches are a true, genuine scandal because we as Christians, if we fall into this model, we should be ashamed. And if you will study what the Scriptures say, read through all the spiritual gifts that you want, take all the spiritual gifts tests that you want to take, you will never find listed anywhere the spiritual gift of spectator. And so the question is your local church making spectators or making disciples? I can't change the whole passive system on my own, but I can commit to be an active member of the body, to use the grace and the giftings that God has given to me to edify my brothers and sisters in Christ and to do my part in the evangelization of the world. Will you make a commitment to likewise turn away from the passive model, to not say that it's okay for this scandal to continue to operate in the local church, but say, as for me and my house, I will be an active member of the body? And if I'm a prominent member, I'm going to use my gifts in that regard. And if I'm a less prominent member of the body, I'm still going to use my gifts to edify the people of God, my brothers and sisters in Christ, and to do my part in the evangelization of the world, that all may hear the good news that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. Get equipped. Obey your King. Glorify your God.